Good day to you. All organisms live in some kind of fluid environment, either air or water, and an important aspect of environmental adaptation involves how they interact with these fluids. As we've seen in other episodes, the Reynolds number is a useful way of understanding how these interactions work. Large organisms like ourselves, or trees, or most animals, operate at relatively high Reynolds numbers, that is, where inertial forces dominate over viscous forces. Small things, like the fluffy seed of a milkweed or a cottonwood, operate at low Reynolds numbers, that is, where viscous forces are more important. That's why a rock falls through the air, but a fluffy seed floats. The descent of the seed is slowed by the air's viscosity. We intuitively understand the world of high Reynolds numbers because we are large. There's an entire world, though, that operates at very low Reynolds numbers, that is, where viscous forces dominate and inertial forces are virtually nil. This is a very strange world that behaves in some very counterintuitive ways. We're going to take a little peek into this world today, and we're going to start by taking a little sample of it. Here we go. And off we go to the microscope. Let's begin by reminding ourselves what the Reynolds number is. It's a ratio of forces acting on a body in a fluid. Inertial forces in the numerator and viscous forces in the denominator. When Reynolds number is high, inertial forces prevail and bodies in motion tend to stay in motion. When Reynolds number is low, it's viscous forces that prevail and this resists motion. Here's the Reynolds number in more detail. In the numerator is the product of the fluid density and its speed, which gives a measure of inertia, and the length of the body. In the denominator is the viscosity. Organisms use two types of motors in low Reynolds number environments, flagella and cilia. A flagellum is a long whip-like thread that undulates back and forth, usually drawing the cell forward, like this one trapped in an empty insect exoskeleton. The flagellum comes in and out of focus, so you have to look carefully, but when it comes into focus, you can see it clearly in this dark field view. Here's the same creature, its motion slowed down, that shows the motion more clearly. Let's watch this sequence again. Sometimes a flagellum pushes the cell forward. It's very difficult to see in this footage, but follow the cell on the right. Look carefully and you'll see the flagellum sometimes comes into focus as a thin line pushing the cell forward. Here are some clips of this same cell, slowed down, that shows the flagellum and its movements a little more clearly. Look carefully at how it undulates. And let's look again. Cilia are structured like flagella. In fact, some scientists argue they're different forms of the same organelle, the undulopodium. Cilia are much shorter undulopodia than flagella are, and cells that use them are usually covered by hundreds of them in a dense array, as you can see here. They're powered by a complicated infrastructure below the cell membrane called a pellicle that coordinates their motion. You can see parts of the pellicle here. The pellicle is part of an extensive network of fibers and tubules in the cell called the cytoskeleton. Cilia are sometimes arranged in complicated shapes, like the beard of cilia on this protist, probably Halteria. The snapping of this spiky array is what powers the cell's jerky movements. Undulopodia aren't always involved in locomotion. In some, like this vorticella, the cell anchors itself to something and uses its cilia to power a flow of water with suspended goodies past its mouth. Undulopodia aren't limited to single-cell creatures like the protists we've seen so far. Larger multicellular animals, like these rotifers, use them too, in arrays of flagella that beat in a coordinated way to draw extensive currents of water past their mouth parts. You can see why rotifers are sometimes called wheel animals. Let's now go to analyzing the fluid motions of these creatures. Let's calculate the Reynolds number, just to see how it's done. We'll use the flagellate that we introduced in the last segment, mainly because it's swimming smoothly and the numbers will be easy to measure. we first have to be able to measure lengths and distances through the microscope. For this, we photograph a special microscope slide that has a tiny rule engraved in it. Now we can measure the actual length of the little guy, which works out to about 16.4 micrometers long. A micrometer is 1/1000th of a meter, or 1/1000th of a millimeter. That's L in the Reynolds number formula. We then measure how far the protist has swum and how long it took to swim there. We divide this distance by the time and we have the swimming speed. That's U in the Reynolds number formula. It's about 16.3 micrometers per second, or 1 body length per second. Now we need the density of water. That's rho in the Reynolds number formula. We can just look that up, and it's about 1,000 kilograms per meter cubed. And finally, we need water's viscosity, which is mu. We can also look that up. It's about 0.001 pascals per second. We now have everything we need to calculate the Reynolds number. To make the units consistent throughout, we divide length and speed each by 1,000,000 to convert micrometers to meters, and then we calculate the number. And our little protist swims at a Reynolds number of about 0.000267. Clearly, this is a regime strongly dominated by viscosity. Let's try to imagine what that viscosity-dominated world is like. A 2-meter-long person swimming through water at a speed of 1 meter per second would have a Reynolds number of about 2 million. That is motion dominated by inertia, not viscosity. To experience the world like our protist does, we would have to swim through a much more viscous liquid. But how viscous? We can calculate this with the Reynolds number formula. It's easier if we redefine viscosity as the kinematic viscosity, which is the ratio of viscosity and density. The kinematic viscosity has units of meters squared per second and has a special name, the stoke. 1 stoke is 10 to the minus 4th meters squared per second. Water has a kinematic viscosity of 0.01 stokes. The Reynolds number now becomes length times speed divided by the kinematic viscosity. For us to swim at the same Reynolds number as the protist, the kinematic viscosity would have to be about 7,500 stokes, 750,000 times more viscous than water. And what kind of fluid would this be? Here are a few examples of viscous fluids. Honey comes in at a paltry 0.7 stokes, 70 times more viscous than water. The viscosity of wood rosin ranges from 1 to about 40 stokes, better, but nowhere near viscous enough. Blackstrap molasses is getting there, with viscosity sitting in the low thousands. What does get us into the proper range is roofing tar, which, depending upon its temperature, has kinematic viscosity ranging from 35 to 55,000 stokes. 7,500 stokes is about what you'd get with hot roofing tar. So there is our comparison. If we swam at a Reynolds number of 0.000267, it would be like swimming through hot roofing tar. You can see this clearly by watching a protist swim in water. Note how sticky the water seems. Let's enhance this to emphasize the motion of particles in the water, and then let's look again at the protist. This is what motion strongly dominated by viscosity looks like. The dominance of viscosity has another interesting consequence for locomotion at low Reynolds number, which goes by the name of added mass. Let's look again at that ciliate. It's quite a large one, about 250 micrometers long, and it swims at a speed of about 100 micrometers per second. That means the Reynolds number is larger, but it's still quite low, averaging about 0.025. When a creature swims at high Reynolds number, the thrust for forward motion comes from imparting backward momentum to the fluid. At low Reynolds number, the stickiness of the fluid means that a swimmer cannot impart backward momentum to the fluid. It's too sticky for that. Consequently, a swimming cell carries water forward with it, dragged along by viscosity. This is called added mass, and it increases the cost of locomotion considerably. Let's estimate this added mass. Here, we take several particles at various distances from the cell and track their motion as the cell moves. This is essentially the motion of the water that is stuck to the cell by viscosity, the added mass. Close to the cell, the water is carried quite far along with it. This water, in turn, drags more distant water along with it, and so on. In the end, the swimming cell carries along water that is as far as 250 micrometers from the cell. If we account for the proportional motion, it adds up to about 200 micrograms, roughly 100 times the mass of the cell itself. It is as if we had to tow a 10-ton load along with us as we swam. Finally, viscosity-dominated flows at low Reynolds numbers require an entirely different style of locomotion. At high Reynolds numbers, momentum imparted to a fluid continues for some time after work has been done on the fluid. For locomotion, this means that only intermittent work is needed to power a body forward because the inertial forces are large enough to overcome viscosity. This is not the case with low Reynolds numbers. Continuous fluid motion requires continuous work. This is easiest to demonstrate in animals that are stationary filter feeders, like these rotifers. Their cilia are concentrated in so-called wheel organs that move a considerable body of water past their mouths. But even small single-cell protists, like this vorticella, do the same thing. How extensive this movement of water can be is seen with this rotifer, which is about a quarter millimeter long. We've done some image analysis to track particle movements, which show up here as white streaks. There's visible motion of particles as far as 1.5 millimeters away, a vast distance at these scales. This extensive reach is made possible by the water's viscosity. When the rotifer puts a parcel of fluid in motion directly with its wheel organ, viscosity drags along a large additional mass of fluid. It is added mass in reverse. When work done by the wheel organ stops, however, viscosity brings the whole thing quickly to a halt. There is no inertia at this scale to keep things flowing. This is easiest to see when the rotifer is startled. Watch as this cluster of bacteria is drawn to the wheel organ. When it touches, the rotifer immediately withdraws. Fluid motion immediately ceases, except for some residual motion caused by the animal's retracting its body. The effect is even more striking in this single-celled vorticella, which, despite being about a tenth the size of the multicellular rotifer, still manages to drive a substantial flow with its cilia. Like the rotifer, the vorticella also sometimes withdraws suddenly, but much faster, and the stoppage of flow is even more dramatic. Okay, let's review what we've learned. First, we saw that small protists get around by two types of motors, flagella and arrays of cilia, that take these tiny organisms through water as if they were crawling through molasses. To move, protists need to keep their motors going all the time. When they stop, forward motion stops immediately. This is unlike what happens with larger animals, where motors, like muscles, can run intermittently. A whale can coast for a long time between intermittent strokes of its flukes, for example. It's the high ratio of inertia over viscosity that does this for the whale. Organisms don't have this advantage at low Reynolds numbers. We also saw that a swimming protist has to not only move its body forward, but along with it, a large mass of water that adheres to it through viscous forces. This means that locomotion for them is more energetically demanding than we might expect at very small body sizes. Well, that's all for now. Until we meet again, this is Scott Turner, wishing you a good day.